From a distance, they seemed to be substantial and to look confidently across the valley. But nearer, this essence dissolves. The limestone chips stare out harshly, and the figures lose all character. The wind has eased away chunks of head and body. Only the long Ionian chitons are distinguishable, and the feet planted squarely apart. Inside, I found long, deep shafts harboring broken stone, dust, and occasionally fragments of bone. They were family graves. In every vault, four or six shafts had been sunk in the rock. An arch had been carved over the recess of each one, or of each pair. In such a sepulchre, perhaps, Joseph of Arimathea laid the body of Christ. Corpses were probably lowered into the clefts in linen robes and wooden coffins, and wealthy men, in the days of Ptolemaic ascendancy, were entombed in anthropoid sarcophagi, carved with the faces of classical Greeks, their chins tufted like pharaohs. I sat by the Roman road to Abila and ate pomegranates. It had once been an important road, but only a few hundred feet of it were recognizable, where it stabbed through the knee of a hill. 6 feet above my head, I saw two inscriptions and felt a surge of homecoming as I recognized not the fetters of Kufic nor the bravado of Arabic Naqsh, but the firm hand of Imperial Rome. Emperor Caesar, M. Or Antoninus, Aug. Armeniacus, and the Emperor Caesar L. Aurel, Verus Aug. Armeniacus, restored the road which the force of the river broke away, the mountain being cut through by the direction of Julius Verus, legate of the province of Syria, at the expense of the people of Abilene. A niche, emptied of its past, gaped above, and a second carving testified to the constructions of Lysias Maximus.